Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the steaming jungles of wherever we are, Africa, I think. Hard to tell. And my name is Adrian Smith. And when I am not podcasting with Rod, I listen to podcasts by Rod. So it is a slightly surreal experience to have him in the room, as it were. So I'd like to introduce once again my co-host, Rod Barnett.
Hello, everyone. Glad to be here. Yeah, I guess...
I was listening to your Conquest episode about an hour ago.
We had a good time with that one.
Yeah, that is... I haven't seen it, but obviously I need to. It got me thinking that maybe we should do a mini-season of Conan ripoffs.
Oh, that would be, honestly, that would be a blast, because that was another, much like the Jungle Girl thing, another very short but intense period of exploitation. Yeah.
Yep. And there are some good, there's some crossover with the sort of Conan stuff that with this film that we're talking about today that I'll get to later. So, yeah. But maybe, you know, I think once we finish this mini season, we need to take a bit of a break from people in loincloths.
And understandable. Yeah.
Get us some films where people have got more clothes on. But anyway, so yeah, it's quite an exciting time. This is our 50th episode, so that's the first thing to mention.
Oh.
I know. We've managed 50. That's fairly good going, I would say.
I'm impressed. I don't know.
I mean, you've done about 6,000 episodes of The Bloody Pit and The Neshikar, so...
No, not quite, but yes.
Got a way to go. But hey, 50 is kind of a milestone, so thank you, everybody. If any of you have been listening since that very first episode, do get in touch. But obviously, we've got bigger news, finally. We've got a couple of exciting things to talk about. I thought, first of all, Rod, you might want to try and persuade our listeners why they should be interested in Dr. Jekyll and the Werewolf.
Ah, well... probably because it is an absolute blast of a film. Paul Naschy's Dr. Jekyll versus the Werewolf, or versus the Wolfman, is one of the Waldemar Daninsky werewolf films that he made starting in 1968. And it is a great film. It has been one of the big blank spots in the releases on Blu-ray. It was released by Mondo Macabro on DVD years ago. They have still had trouble getting their hands on the unclothed version of the film. Of course, it being a Spanish film produced during the time of General Franco, there were two versions, one for domestic use where everyone is covered up, and one where for export to us nasty people out here in the rest of the world who want to see nudity. The good news is this new release that is going to go on, it's going to be pre-orderable on Halloween Day, is going to have both versions of the film. The unclothed version, the bits that are different from the clothed version will unfortunately come from a different... A lesser quality print, but it's the only way that they could do what they wanted to do, which is to present both versions of the film. Mondo Macabro has worked their tails off. This movie's they're actually presenting it also as part of the set on UHD, so not just Blu-ray, but even more high definition version of the film being released as part of that set. It's very exciting. Two versions of the film, a raft of extras, and a commentary track from Troy Gwynn and myself, we of the Naschy cast, which is very exciting. We were thrilled to be able to do another Naschy film, especially one of the werewolf films, and this one's a blast. For those of you curious, we did produce two slightly different versions of the commentary track, one for the clothed version and one for the nude version.
So in the second one, you yourselves recorded the commentary naked, is that right?
Well, we always do it in loincloths. We don't want to embarrass each other.
Yeah, so congratulations on having basically two UHD discs under your belt in virtually the same week.
I'm a little surprised.
It's pretty cool. Is this the first UHD 4K release for Paul Naschy?
You know, actually, I think... It might be the second, but I'll be honest, I'm not positive. I forgot to think about. I didn't even think about that. I have to admit.
Yeah, it just shows that there's future in these films, that they're interested in getting them out on the greatest format possible that most of us still can't afford.
No. That's right. The first might have been the Werewolf versus the Vampire Woman. That
Yeah.
came out from Vinegar Syndrome. I think that
Oh,
one,
that's it,
that
yeah.
one included a 4K. So this would be the
Which
second.
I think you and I, you invited me onto the Nashi cast a few years ago to talk about that film, I think.
It's a wonderful film. It's
Yeah,
amazing.
it's very funny. Is that the one where there's a big fight at the end with just the two of them rolling around on the floor?
Yes, in mist and slow motion at times.
It's really good. So I mentioned there that this is your that you've got two UHD commentary releases at the moment, because finally the one that we've been teasing for weeks and weeks and weeks has finally been announced since our last episode, which is, of course, and many of you would probably have guessed by now anyway, Severin's Danza Macabre Volume 2 actually does now feature Danza Macabre, which was supposed to be in the first set, but it wasn't ready, which is good for us because it meant that we could come in at the last minute and say, hey, you know who'd be good at doing a commentary for Danza Macabre, aka Castle of Blood? And now, originally, I was told that they'd already got a commentary track, but they said, yeah, we've got room for two. And then finally, so it's been announced this past week, and we are the main commentary on it. So I can only assume that we just blew the other one out of the water.
Or
With our.
I was unaware of this. I was not aware that there was another. Oh, there was a previous commentary that.
I don't actually know. I'm sure the other one was very good as well. I'm not sure what happened. They have got a scene-specific commentary by Barbara Steele.
Oh, that which is wonderful. Yeah, I can't wait to hear that.
Yeah. I know, right? So we are in excellent company, but I am so excited. I love this film with all my heart, and I have done ever since I first saw it, which was actually not that long ago, within only in the last 10 years or so, as I keep regularly saying I'm playing catch up with a lot of this stuff. But so I watched it because it was a Margheriti film, but I was just absolutely blown away by it, and I've loved it ever since. So yeah. Very exciting. We did a I did an interview on this podcast a few months ago with the producer of the well the daughter of the original one of the original producers who runs the company Cinematheque Lear, and they are the ones who've been responsible for doing this restoration. And so I'd been in touch with them for a couple of years already anyway, so I knew about the restoration, but it was very exciting to discover that Severin were going to do it. And anyway, we're on it. So we did loads of research, I think it's fair to say. It was pretty packed. If you listen to the Severin podcast, where they talk about all the extras on this set, Kat Ellinger just describes our commentary as dense.
And we'd like to stress that it's the commentary that's described as dense and not us.
know.
Thank
So
goodness.
it's just like my school reports again. So yeah, that's exciting because they're doing it as a UHD and Blu-ray. Which I know some people meet sort of not too happy about that because it means the whole box set is more expensive. And I still don't have a 4K player anyway, or a TV. But nevertheless, it is there. So there are three discs devoted to Castle of Blood. So this is basically a Castle of Blood box set with some bonus features.
With like three other films, yes.
Exactly, yeah. So there's a TV show called Jekyll, based on Jekyll and Hyde. There is a vampire film by the director of Baba Yaga called They Have Changed Their Face. And then there is one which I'm sure will be the first film you'll be popping in when you get this box, is The Devil's Lover, starring Rosalba Neri.
Yes, actually, probably so, because I'll be honest, I can't remember if I've ever seen it.
Yeah, well, I definitely haven't, but I have seen Rosalba Neri before.
Yes. Yes, and those
So
of us
I,
who have seen her are very happy that we have.
yeah, yeah. Obviously, Lady Frankenstein is fab, and you and I did a podcast on that several years ago. And then we talked about her in relation to Top Sensation, I think, when we did the commentary for Sex of Angels.
Oh, that's true.
So she's been on our radar. And then also there is a soundtrack CD thrown in, but not for Castle of Blood, but for the Devil's Lover. Anyway, it's a really packed set, and I am so excited to be in there. Not only because I love Castle of Blood, but also because this will be my first time being involved in a Severin release, because, as I mentioned on here before, I was cut out of the documentary that was on the Blu-ray release for Nightmares in a Damaged Brain. So my biggest fear was with this that we'd do this commentary and we'd send it in and then it would end up not being used and I'd be like, oh, Severin have just got it in for me. So it was a big relief when they finally announced it and I could see us on here. So yeah, two very exciting releases to look forward to. I know it all costs loads of money, but hey, what else is it for? Retirement?
Yeah, really, retirement, medications, who cares? Is this ridiculous?
Passing it on to your offspring or significant others? No, just
they don't enjoy deserve life. It. Come on.
Enjoy life while you can. yeah. So anyway, so those two releases were announced this month because it's sort of Halloween time and Dr. Jekyll is going on sale on Halloween. And if this was any normal cult film podcast, this episode we're recording right now on the 21st, what are we? Yeah, of October. We'd be recording a Halloween special, but we don't do things here like other people because this time we're still talking about Jungle Girls.
We kind of, it's consider it a holdover from warmer months. That would be a good idea. Yeah.
Yes, in these chilly times, it's nice to look at a film where everyone's quite warm and enjoying splashing around in the ponds and swimming pools of the Rome studios that they're pretending.
Yes, that they're pretending are in Africa. Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, so we are, of course, talking about a film that you recommended we include in this season, which goes under a couple of different names. Luana, la figlia della foresta vergine, or Luana, the virgin child of the forest. I think, or virgin daughter of the forest, or daughter of the virgin forest. Either way, other people just call it Luana, or of course, Luana the Jungle Girl.
Called Luana the Girl Tarzan, which seems to be a little silly, but okay.
It's a bit on the nose. I mean, she does swing from the trees.
This is true.
What I do like, of course, is this film does actually have a character who is George of the Jungle.
Yes, I know. I'll admit is amusing and one of the stranger little tidbits within the film.
Yeah,
of course it's yeah.
This film has a very similar plot to our last film, and I'm quite confident that the next two films we do will also have quite similar plots.
Yes. So,
but this film does have a lot of interesting stuff to say about it, I think. So let's start off by just talking a little bit about the director and the stars, because that's where the more interesting element comes in, I think. So the film was directed by, now he's got it, what's his name? I've not written it down.
Roberto Infascelli?
Yeah, Infascelli, but on the credits it says something else, doesn't it?
Yeah, like I forget Bob. What this on-screen credit, but it's definitely an anglicized pseudonym.
This is great podcasting right here. hang on, let me see if I can find it. Oh yeah, so
Bob Raymond.
Bob Raymond as Roberto Infascelli. He is not what you would call prolific.
No.
In fact, he only directed two films, this one, and then 5 years later, actually one that is pretty well known, I would say, The Great Kidnapping, La Polizia sta a guardare, which is a Polizia Teschi film, which I think is quite a good one. It's got Lee J. Cobb in it, and I don't know. Have you ever seen that one, The Great Kidnapping?
No, I have not seen that one, but it is highly rated, and so it is one of those that I'm going to have to eventually seek out. It seems like this guy, much better known as a producer than a director.
Yeah, and he wrote a few things as well. He wrote films like Night Train Murders and Puzzle by Duccio Tessari. So, yeah, not a, but even then, quite a, considering the Italian film industry, people were just doing hundreds of things. He didn't actually have a huge career, but yeah, writing, producing, he produced some Westerns.
Yeah.
And some Polizia Teschi films.
Including Blind Man, which I have definitely seen, so yes. Mm.
And then, unfortunately, he was killed in a car crash when he was only, wasn't even 40 when he died, sadly. Mm. So, yeah, quite a relatively small career. He started out as a production manager in the early 60s and then seems to just sort of segued into writing and then directing a couple of the films as well. But so Luana was his first film as director, but he didn't write this one. So it would be interesting to know.
Well, are we sure
of
that?
Or did he?
Because I checked the writing credit, and I think it's a fake name because it's literally
Louis
the
Road.
Only credit given for this particular name.
That's true. It's possible, isn't it? It's hard to say. There's so little in sort of production information available about the movie. But it was clearly made because these were the films that everybody was making at the moment. And
this is what was hot, baby.
Yeah, they'd just come out of watching Gungala and thought, right, we can do that. And they did. It was an Italian-German co-production, but with a sort of international cast. So it's just worth mentioning, I think, three of them, basically. We could start, we'll go in reverse order. So one of our characters, or the main female lead, who isn't Luana, is a character called Isabel, and she is extremely recognisable to any Italian cult film fan. That is Evie Mirandi, who has popped up on this podcast because of Planet of the Vampires, of course.
Definitely.
And she is also in From the Orient with Fury, which is a Euro spy film that I have spent a lot of time with over the years and was in my PhD and stuff, so I feel like I know her quite well. But there's lots of other films that she's in that I haven't seen. Are you familiar with her career beyond Planet of the Vampires?
I do know from the Orient with Fury, and I saw her in Duel of Champions from 1961 as well. But as far as being, you know, more familiar with her career, not really. Just, you know, I've seen a couple of her films across, you know, the ones that she did. I was unaware until doing some research for this just how many of the Eurospy films that she was in. I did not know that from the Orient with Fury was only one of about six of those that she was in. I was kind of stunned by that.
And
kind of makes me
making
think,
them very close together. It's like she just walked out of one studio straight into the next one and then straight into the next one. She made a whole bunch in a sort of 2 years.
Oh, I know. The release dates on them were insane.
Yeah.
She did one called Gold Singer. Get it? Gold Singer. The same year that she did Planet of the Vampires and From the Orient with Fury. And then in 66, she was in at least four. Wow. She ate out and bought her clothes based on the Eurospy genre there for at least 2 or 3 years. So,
and it's possible that she might pop up in our next season because she also did one of the sort of Fumetti superhero films, Goldface, the Fantastic Superman. So,
yeah,
I'm not
cool.
sure
yeah.
if that's on our list, but she might pop up again. But yeah, and she gets a lot more to do in this film than she did in Planet of the Vampires, I think. Because obviously that one is much more of a, there's a lot more going on, and there's a lot of characters with speaking roles and so on. But
well, her character in this film actually does a lot more than even the title character.
Yeah, well, yes, quite. And so Isabel's companion on this adventure that she is on in the African jungles is our character George of the jungle, played by another actor who we are going to see again in our next season, Glenn Saxon. And he is an actor from Holland originally, but spent most of his career in Italy, and also Germany. He did a few German films too. And of course, he was the masked supervillain Criminal.
With a K.
In a couple of films, Criminal and its sequel, Il Macho di Criminal. And we're definitely doing Criminal. I've definitely got that on the list.
Cool.
But he did a few other things. He played Django. He's done a few films that I don't know if it was mostly quite sort of culty. Was there anything else, any of his westerns that you're familiar with?
No, I've seen Django Shoots First, but I'm more curious. I know I've definitely seen Criminal, but I don't know that I ever, or Criminal. I don't know Criminal. That I ever got to see the sequel to it. So that's an interesting area to go into. I was a little shocked at how short his career was, given that he seems to have been, you know, a pretty solid little actor on screen at least. And he definitely gets the job done. He's got the requisite chiseled features and dark eyes that are required for, you know, anybody who's supposed to play Django. And it just becomes a question of exactly what went down there, because it seems like up until about 1970 or 71 he was working along, and then he switched gears and went in another direction, and then only sporadically does he return to the screen.
He became, in the 70s, he became a producer on Italian television for Rai and people like that. So I think that's mainly why he stopped acting. I think he didn't really want to do the kinds of films that he was getting offered, like the jerk, because he was in some German sex comedies, and I guess he felt like that wasn't the direction he really wanted to go. So
yeah, well, think about the phrase you just uttered. Think about the phrase German sex comedy. You know?
Yeah.
Think. Wow.
And your point being?
Oil and water? That's just what I'm thinking.
Yeah, he's in some of the Sexy Susan films, or Frau Wirtlin. And I've seen bits of those, and they're, you know, potentially funny. At least one of them has Edward Fennec in, but I'm not sure if that's one of the ones that he is in. So there was a bit of crossover between the Italians and the Germans with those films.
But yeah.
Anyway, I guess, you know, European comedy in general is an acquired taste. But yeah, so that's Glenn Saxon. So we'll look forward to seeing him, or at least seeing his skull mask coming up in our next season. But of course, we're building up to the star who's got the title role, even though she has no lines of dialogue at all.
Does not utter a sound.
She doesn't even do any kind of chimp noises or anything. So we have here Luana, played by an actress called Mei-Chen. And she had quite a year when this film came out. She basically had an amazing time for about a year and a half, 2 years, and then retired. So I was trying to find out more about her and who she was, because she did things like, obviously this film, she's in The Rape of the Vampire, the Jean Roland film.
Yeah, very, 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 very small role there. Blink and you'll miss her.
Yeah, so it's mainly, apart from Luana, all the other films she did were in, was in France. She's even in a film which I've never really heard of by Borachik, called Théâtre de Monsieur et Madame Cabal. I don't know anything about that one at all. Outside of The Beast, I have very little experience of Borachik. So interesting movies, nothing major. Probably The Rape of the Vampire is the most famous one she did. So I was trying to find out a bit more about her and where she's from and everything. And she's actually got quite an interesting story. So she is originally from Vietnam and was born in 1949. So she were, you know, during the Vietnam War, her mother managed to get her out of where all the bad stuff was going on. There was a war.
It was a war, yes. It was horrible.
But so So she, Mei-Chen, was married to a guy called Francois Chalais, who was 30 years older than her. And he was a journalist, a French journalist who was covering the Vietnam War. He was the person who tracked down John McCain and interviewed him in a North Vietnam hospital.
Yeah.
Which became quite a famous interview. So that was Francois Chalais. So while somehow, and I don't know the full story, I've been trying to research it, but most of it's written in French and I've not managed to get to the bottom of it. But basically, somehow they met in Vietnam and he fell in love with this girl who was only about 19 and brought her back to France. They got married and immediately she jumped into modeling and acting for about 2 years. So she did the films that we've mentioned. She also appeared in magazines. She's in Mayfair magazine. So she did some sort of men's photo shoot type stuff. So she's in Mayfair and at least one other magazine called, what was it called? I've got it written down. Girl Illustrated. Classy stuff. So if you search for her online, some of those pictures will pop up, as well as some publicity photos for this film. So when she made this film, she was still only 19. And then she seems to have just packed all that in and dedicated herself to her marriage. And it wasn't until he died. So they'd always planned, apparently, they'd planned to go back to Vietnam many years later. But he died in 1996. So in 97, she got involved in making some documentaries and went back to Vietnam and made documentaries for French television. But he's a really big deal in France as a journalist. There's a sort of documentary prize at Cannes named after him, for example.
Yeah.
So quite an interest. And there are photos of her more recently. I've been trying to find where she is now, because now she'd be in her sort of early 70s. I've not been able to track down what she's doing right now, but there are pictures of her not that long ago at events and stuff. So she's still around. But yeah, quite interesting that she's got all this extra sort of stuff to her background and then just randomly took her clothes off a lot for a year and then stopped, basically.
I wish there was more information out there. I wonder if she has ever done an interview in any language talking about her time making the few movies that she made.
Yeah. It would be really interesting to know more about that period, you know, coming from Vietnam to France. And because her husband was a kind of celebrity journalist, I guess that's how some connections were made. And she got invited to do modeling, which must have then led to getting cast in some of these films. I don't know how good her language skills were. Maybe that's why she doesn't speak. I don't know if she speaks in any of the other films because I haven't seen them.
Yeah.
But yeah, who knows? It's quite interesting though. So yeah, that's about as much as I was able to find out about her specifically. But the film itself was quite a big hit and got quite a lot of distribution. I looked it up. In the UK, it was released in 1969. Mm-hmm. By a company called Border Films. And I don't know if I've mentioned them. I probably have before, because they did a lot of low-budget European exploitation. I wrote a lot about Border Films in my PhD. Sorry to keep dropping that. I've done a PhD. You all know. I'm sorry I keep going on about it. but it was because my focus was film distributors, and so Border came up. They had a really interesting history. A couple of years after this, Border were in court in London, charged with obscenity for the screening of a Swedish sex education film called More About the Language of Love. And there's a whole court case, and I've written quite a lot about it. Really interesting company. They're part of a family of business, well, part of a group of businesses that all were run by the same family. Mm-hmm. And the guy that ran it, EJ Fancy, he basically had two wives at the same time with children by both.
Yes, you've talked about that before. I still love that story.
So his second wife, Olive, she ran Border, and his first wife worked with him at EJ Fancy Productions, and they were just in different offices in Soho, like just down the road from each other. and their kids. So he had four children, two by each wife, and they all worked for the companies. Really bizarre. Anyway, so that was, I was quite pleased to see the border connection with this movie. But the reason I wanted to mention distribution is because clearly there was a lot of ambition behind the distribution of this film in America, because as I'm sure you've seen, and hopefully other people will have seen these, or they will by the time I've tweeted a few more images, but there was a lot of there was a big attempt to make this into kind of a big movie. It's like they were attempting what was done with Hercules a few years earlier,
yeah,
where you take a cheap European film and then pump loads of money into it and make it a big thing. So Capital Films were the company that picked this up, run by a guy called Sol Fried, who I can't find anything out about at all, and I've been looking through Variety articles and everything, I can't find much about him. But they got what's his name, Alan Dean Foster,
yep,
to write a novelization for this movie, which that seems really bizarre to me. You're just taking at face value, why this film? Why would you bother? But that was clearly part of the efforts to make it a much more important film than it actually was.
Well, I know, and they went out of their way. I mean, the amazing poster art would be the spot where you would say, wow, they really decided yeah. to spend some money on this thing.
Well, they have artwork by Frank Frazetta.
Mm-hmm.
Although allegedly, depending on what you read, I've read it differently in other places, but some people say Frank Frazetta did the artwork for the poster. Other things I've read say that it was adapted from his artwork. But I'm more inclined to believe it was actually done for this, because he's got specific animals in the poster that are in here. So,
yeah.
Although in his artwork, she's holding a spear, which sadly doesn't happen, I don't think, in the film.
Yes, we're once again, this is a jungle girl whose actions in the film involve essentially observing people.
And there's a couple of versions of the artwork, and one of them was then reused mm-hmm. on the cover of a Edgar Rice Burroughs novel, Savage Pellucidar, which I think I had a copy of at one time. I definitely recognize it. So there's a couple of Frank Rosetta's, there's like two versions of the same basic pose that she's doing
mm-hmm.
that he used. I'll tweet some of these out. But yeah, pretty amazing. But not only that, there was also a comic strip adaptation.
I know.
Which I found online, which is really cool, actually. And it was included, it was published in Vampirella magazine.
Yes. issue 31 of Vampirella here in the States, which is as soon as you see the artwork that was used for the cover, you realize, oh, okay, this is a variation on the poster art, or a different version of the character presented in that same way. But yeah, I was a little stunned to learn this, which is, you know, it's absolutely fascinating. There was this 1974 full court press in the States to advertise this film.
I know, it seems like they were really trying to turn it into a big hit, and I'm going to guess that it probably didn't work, because like I said, I was looking at Variety, and that's where they pick up on any news of what was going on at the time, and there's not even a review in Variety, which is quite unusual. So I don't know whether it's still, despite all this artwork and stuff that was created in the comic strip, if maybe they just didn't do that many actual prints. I don't know, but there's no review in Variety. There might be in some local papers, but I hadn't been able to find one, unfortunately.
Oh, that's a shame. I'd be curious to know how well the film did here in the States.
I don't know. Yeah, I've got no idea, which is a shame. But yeah, this Russ Manning was the artist who did the comic strip, and it's really cool. So I'll post a couple of images out from that as well.
Well, not only that, there's the those comic strips were done by Russ Manning, and then the version that shows up in Vampirella was done by other people.
Oh.
There was an adaptation written by Doug Minch, who's one of my favorite 1970s and 1980s comic book writers, and with artwork by one of my favorite from the Warren years, the Warren black and white comic magazines. I just love his work, Esteban Moroto. Extremely great artwork, and without a doubt, a much better version of any story linked to this than the film.
Yeah.
But it's a wonderful thing to see.
Do you know, I hadn't realized until you just said that it was two different comic strips. I thought it was the same one.
No. There's the one it published in Vampirella is the one that Maroto did.
So where was the Russ Manning one published then? I'm not sure.
To be honest, I think that it was primarily used as advertising art as part of part of the...
It's the kind of thing that could have been reproduced in local papers and stuff. Mm-hmm. I guess.
They were essentially called promo strips, and they were done. Right. They were laid Got out it. In such a way so that they could be presented as either like the standard three strip newsprint newspaper strips, one at a time, or they could be reproduced. The panels could be rearranged so that they could be presented as essentially like two pages or three pages that would assemble itself into a kind of short comic story. It's fascinating. It's very clear that Russ Manning was basing his work on the Frazetta images that were already present. And but Russ Manning was an amazing artist. It's really dynamic stuff.
Yeah.
But then, like I say, you have two different artistic. If you count the painting done by Frank Frazetta, you've got three. Great artists from that period of time working in fantasy artwork who have their fingers on Luana, and I don't know that you could ever say that about another one of these Jungle Girl films.
I know, it's amazing. And then, so yeah, I'm just looking at one of these ads that was, yeah, like you said, it must have been for the paper. And it does say Luana opens Wednesday, November 7th, citywide, mm-hmm. at theatres and drive-ins near you. So it seems like there was a really big push. Just makes you wonder why Sol Fried figured that this was the film, of all the films he had that he could have used. I did find one article about him in Variety about Capital Productions. They had an 8-feature release program for 1972. Films like Keep Off the Grass, The Fear Maker, White Teacher in a Black School, which I've never heard of that. I don't know what that is. But then he refers to Luana as being released for the kiddie market, which is interesting.
Oh my.
It was being sold as a... But that's what I thought was interesting as well with the BBFC rating for the UK. It was a U rating. And in the States, it's a PG. So this was being aimed at children, despite the fact that the star of the film is running around...
Starkers.
Just wearing a G-string.
Yeah.
And a guy gets eaten by a giant plant. So,
and my favorite scene in the movie.
Yeah. So yeah, it's interesting. So Sol Fried did also, he sort of produced a couple of movies and then seems to have just dropped off the face of the planet. So yeah, it's a mystery that they put so much effort into this particular film, and I can only assume it's because he was just picking up whatever he could get that was cheap.
I guess.
And then figured he would try and use that that sort of Joseph E. Levine technique of taking something and turning it into something huge, which was the trick that he pulled off with Hercules and Hercules Unchained. But yeah, worth checking out. The artwork is really cool. Now the Alan Dean Foster novelization, have you ever read that?
Yes, I read it years ago. As a matter of fact, I ran across the first time I ever had any knowledge of Luana at all was I ran across a copy of his novelization in a used bookstore was simply stunned. I was like, I had no idea what in the world this was, but the cover art, of course, was gorgeous. And having been a fan of Alan Dean Foster from a lot of his science fiction work over the years, plus it's impossible to not be a science fiction movie fan and not run across his name because of his novelizations of a lot of the bigger films over the years.
Yeah.
I mean, Alien and the first three Alien films. His work in the kind of novelization movie tie-in stuff is legendary, and so I got very curious about it. I had not yet read the novel. And at the time, did not have any way to actually see the film. But I got curious about it, and I looked up Mr. Foster's website and found that you could contact him. You could send him a note on his website.
Oh, nice.
So I did. I wrote Alan Dean Foster and asked him about this, and he was nice enough to write back. We wrote back and forth a few times with him answering my questions. He was very nice about it. It was very cool. And so that's when I learned that that Luana in 1974 was actually the first movie novelization he ever did. He was contacted and asked if he would be willing to do this. He said yes, and so I asked him, you know, what was the process like? Well, how did it happen? And he said, well, there was no shooting script of the film available. He said, I did the novelization after watching it in Italian, which I don't speak. I didn't know that it was based on anything else. I didn't know what the background of the film was. I have no idea. I had no idea about it. So essentially he watched the film in Italian and realized, okay, I don't really know exactly what is going on here. I can surmise it. So he kind of just made up his own story to do the novelization, you know, keeping with what was on the screen in front of him and just making up the details on his own. So, he was kind of amused by the fact that the funniest thing that revolves around his involvement with Luana is that after the novel was published, Disney got in touch with him. They had read the book and wanted to buy the film rights from him, and they didn't realize at the time that it was a novelization of an existing film,
even though it was basically a new story.
Right, right. So nothing ever happened with that, of course. But at the same time, my fascination with this started there, and so after writing back and forth with him, I of course then sat down and read the novel and realized that his story is much better than the one in the film. I don't remember the details of it. I do just remember that beyond just the things that you would expect from a novelization, which is, you know, broadening the story out and deepening it so that a novel allows you to get inside the heads of characters and get into their motivations and get into what drives them and therefore makes for a more satisfying story overall. It also just was a better version of what was on the screen, no matter how you slice it. And it's one that I've held on to because I know eventually I will want to reread it.
Cool.
Just to remind myself of, this was not only his first attempt at this, but you know, one that proves that if you just would have employed a writer at the outset, you know, someone other than whoever this fake name Lewis was it Lewis Reed? I can't even
Lewis
remember.
Lewis Rode.
Lewis Rode. Yeah, you might, you know, you could have come up with something probably the same budget that was much more interesting.
And do they use the Frank Frazetta image on the front?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, when I discovered there was a book, it was sort of too late for me to get one and read it before we recorded this. But hey, if anybody is planning on doing a full restoration of Luana and is going to put it out on Blu-ray and needs two guys to do a commentary track, I will read the book first for that. I mean, this is another film that would look gorgeous. It looks like it's really beautifully shot, but unfortunately the copy is not great.
It's a little shocking to note that there is a fair number of, well, let's put it this way. There's a certain percentage of the stuff that takes place outdoors, supposedly in Africa, that is actually shot outdoors. Probably not in Africa, but there's a combination of the, well, what we've come to expect from Jungle Girl films of this type, which is that, you know, it's a set pretending to be somewhere outdoors in Africa, but there are a number of spots where, you know, they're really outdoors. They're out in the real world.
Yeah. In a park in the middle of Rome, probably.
Probably.
But no, there are, there's, I mean, they're using, we've got various different animals, which I'm assuming are probably from a local circus or something.
Oh, no.
There's Luana's best friend is a chimp, and I honestly, every time that chimp comes on screen, I'm just terrified for Luana in case this is the moment where he decides he's had enough and he's just going to rip her face off.
Yeah, who knows? Chimps are indecipherable.
Yeah, but thankfully that doesn't happen. So I have a plot summary, which I thought we could just go through, even though...
Cool, yeah.
You know, if you heard us talk about the previous film, then
it's pretty close.
We could almost use the same plot summary. But anyway, so I've got a plot summary from the monthly film bulletin review, because this was reviewed when it came out here in the UK. And it's quite a good plot summary. So here we go. Anxious to recover. Now, bits of this that are not my memory of the film, but anyway. Anxious to recover the papers lost when her scientist father, Donovan, was killed some years ago in a plane crash in the virtually unexplored Trangangala country. Isabel persuades author adventurer George Barrett, the only person familiar with the territory, to act as her guide. So yeah, well, the film starts where we see George in some previous adventure, which ends with him getting a load of poison darts blown into him, and he's kind of lying on the floor. And then I think we're supposed to believe that after that he quits being an adventurer and just spends all his time in a local bar playing cards.
And mostly drinking.
Yeah, drinking. So she tracks him down. I'm fairly sure that exact same thing happens in at least one of the cannibal films. Which one is it? Which is the cannibal film with Mimi Lai? Oh, Eaten Alive.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure this starts the same way. So she persuades him to come with her. Now, it says here that she's anxious to recover papers. I don't remember papers getting mentioned. I thought she just wanted to find the plane where she wanted to find her father, because he died in a plane crash in the jungle.
Yeah, there seemed to be some hemming and hawing about what they might be able to recover from the plane crash if they were able to find it and so on. Yeah.
So eventually he agrees, so it says here they're joined by Fulbright, Donovan's former partner, and Isabel's trustee and self-appointed guardian, who has previously tried to persuade her not to take the trip. And of course we should mention that she is wearing a necklace with a sort of pendant on it that we've seen before in the film, because when George of the Jungle was incapacitated by the blow darts, he gets briefly sort of rescued by this beautiful woman, Luana, who is wearing the same necklace.
Yep.
And so now, whenever he sees this necklace, he has this kind of weird moment where he has to hold his temple and close his eyes because he's gone a bit dizzy. So somehow seeing this thing again is bringing back some sort of trace memory of the poison in his bloodstream and confusing him. So I think that when he sees that, it persuades him that he should do this, because clearly, it's important. Anyway, a series of mysterious incidents en route suggest that someone wishes to prevent the party reaching their destination. Now, there's a couple of things that happen. There's a bad guy who wants to stop them, and he is in with the local tribes people. Mm-hmm. And there's a brilliant scene where the two of them have to arm wrestle, and where they lie on the floor, and whoever loses the arm wrestle gets their hand stung by a scorpion.
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but they look like real scorpions to me.
Well, they were definitely real scorpions when they were dumped out in those little thorny circles to hold them into a certain spot. But I did notice that once the arm wrestling began, they were definitely not real scorpions.
Really?
The movements became much less indicative of something that has a will of its own. Let's put it that way.
See, I didn't notice because the copy I was watching wasn't so hot. But maybe in a better copy, if it were obvious. But I was really impressed.
Oh, it's a cool sequence. It's one of those moments where, let's be clear, these Jungle Girl movies, they are, as I have said before, much of a sameness. You're not going to find a lot of variation on the kind of story being told, or even how it's going to be told to you from one film to the next. So when this scene pops up, it's one of the first moments in the film where you're like, oh, well, I haven't seen this before. This is kind of cool.
Yeah, it is cool. Yeah, that's definitely a moment of interest. And so he beats this guy. And because of that, it turns out this guy is working secretly with Fulbright. They're in on something together, which is sort of interesting, I think. Anyway, back to the plot summary, sorry. Thanks to George, they evade traps and perils and are further helped by a jungle girl known as Luana, revered by the tribes as a goddess. We're not really told why, but apparently she's a goddess. I mean, last time she was a goddess because she had that jewel around her neck. This time she's a goddess because she can speak to the chimps. I don't know.
Well, she does. She does seem to have the ability to kind of. I don't know if the word control would be too strong a word, but she does seem to be able to influence animals to do things that they wouldn't necessarily do on their own, which is demonstrated a couple of times. Most effectively, I think, when one of the members of the safari are about to be attacked. Well, no, there's a well. It's when the natives have tied out a goat to get a lion or
a lion.
I think it's a lion to get into a particular area, and she actually is able to command this lion to not attack the goat and to leave, and
it's quite impressive because that really is her
in
the scene with a real lion and a real goat. I mean that's a very well-trained lion, or perhaps a lion that's had a lot of food already, so he just isn't bothered about the goat.
I will say that this time, watching that scene, the thing that popped into my mind, amusingly enough, is that when she unties the goat and lets it go off on its own, the goat goes off in the same direction the lion went. And I'm like, man, some animals you just can't save.
I know. I thought that as well. It's funny. There's also a great scene where Luana goes into the camp at night, which I swear is the same set as the camp in the last film.
I know. They honestly could have just passed these sets from one production to the next.
And so Luana is sort of checking out these people, and particularly she's interested in Isabel. And there's a great scene where Isabel goes for a naked swim in the by the waterfall. And so Luana steals her clothes, which is pretty funny. Because then there's a hilarious comedy scene where Luana's trying to work out what you do with a bra. And so she puts it on her head, which is pretty funny.
I like it. She drapes it around her hips and puts it on her head,
So we find out that Fulbright is a baddie, and he's working with this other guy. And he's trying to stop. He wants them to kill Luana because Luana is well, I think by now we know. Or Isabel knows, or George knows, somebody knows that Isabel knows, sorry, that her father, he had a second marriage to what they call an Oriental princess.
Yes.
And so when the plane crashed, it was the father, this woman, and a three-year-old child. So now we know that Luana is the sort of grown-up of that.
Yes, she's now 18 years old.
Yeah.
Mute and in command of animals. Yes.
Yeah. Fulbright wants her dead because he's basically got some kind of secret he's trying to keep covered up that he thinks she will reveal. I'm not entirely sure how because she doesn't speak.
Yeah. Let's discuss this secret. I mean, let's be clear. They've cast an actor in this film in that role. The actor playing Norman. Who was the business partner of Isabel's father. There's this back and forth between the two of them for the first half of the film where Isabel's wanting to, kind of confess information about her father and, the second marriage and the child and the whole nine yards.
Yeah.
And Norman is doing his best to keep her from speaking about this information like we're in a like we're in a genteel society party where we want to keep things above board. And then so when she does put this out there, it just makes it all the more evident that there's something going on here, because the actor that they've cast as Norman, he's right out of central casting for slyly villainous. He's obviously going to turn out to be a badden no matter what happens. And that is true. But at the same time, I've got to know, by the time they introduce the plot element that is driving Norman to be there in the jungle, to be concerned that information about Isabel's father doesn't become more publicly known. By the time we get to that plot element, I was just like, wow, okay, that's unexpected. I mean, don't get me wrong, it does explain the cooperation of the native bad guy. You know, essentially there's a lot of money being made here. But at the same time, it's one of those things where it's just like, wow, they kept that in their back pocket for a long period of time in this story.
I know. Incidentally, this actor is Pietro Tordi, and he was in, amongst other films, Quo Vadis and Ben-Hur. So, according to the IMDb, he'd been in over 150 things. So, Luana, being the bad guy in Luana and having to get eaten by a hungry plant, was just another day at the office for him, I think.
And, yes, and possibly the low point of his career? It's hard to know.
Yeah. So, there's this whole conspiracy that he's involved in. So it turns out they eventually realize, because Luana flirts with George, and then she shows him that there is a plane crash, but it's in a lake. So unlike the last film where there was a fun, sexy photo shoot by a plane with a skeleton still hanging out of it, this time the plane has crashed into a lake and Luana knows where it is. She swum down there, which must suggest to me that when she was 3 years old, she was able to get her seatbelt off and swim out of the crashed plane.
Oh, come on. This was the 1950s when this would have happened. Seatbelts didn't exist.
Maybe she was thrown out of the window before it crashed into the lake.
Possibly. Who knows? Probably rescued by a kind crocodile.
Yeah. So she has revealed to Joel that she knows where this plane crashes. So he goes down there. They've brought their scuba gear. So him and Isabel head down there. They discover, they come back from the plane with a sealed, helpfully watertight suitcase, briefcase. And in there is a diary, which reveals that Donovan had discovered a carnivorous plant. Oh, yeah, because I don't think we'd mentioned he was a scientist. Anyway, so he's discovered a carnivorous plant from which a powerful drug can be extracted. And Fulbright, who is his partner, had been trying to get him and to exploit the drug and had been trying to kill him. There'd been two attempts on his life already. And now, obviously, the plane crash was the third and final one. So this is where the big reveal happens. But we've already known that Fulbright is a bad guy by this point, so it's not a huge surprise. And then the local tribe turn up again. And the guy whose name I keep forgetting that we saw earlier on in the film, Ukeke, is it?
Oh, yeah, Ukeke, played by Alfred Thomas, yeah.
Yeah, so that's been Fulbright's partner in crime. And so him and George end up having a fight next to this big killer plant whilst they're surrounded by the tribe's people with pointing their blow darts at them. And then Luana turns up again, and all the tribe's people say, "Luana," and they all run away.
Yep, not going to mess with her.
And George takes that moment of distraction to shove our baddie. What did I just say his name was? I'm so sorry.
Norman.
Ukeke.
I'm sorry. Yeah, Ukeke.
Isn't it Ukeke? It's not Norman. It's Ukeke who gets shoved into the plant.
Yes, indeed.
And
suffer and a fate dies. Worse than, I don't know.
Isn't it? Oh, so then, because in here it says Fulbright falls victim to the plant. But it's not, isn't it? It's Ukeke. Fulbright's not fighting with him. Don't they just take Fulbright back with them at the end on the boat?
Oh my goodness. I hate to say this. I just rewatched this film last night and I can't remember. Oh my goodness.
I'm pretty sure Fulbright's just looking a bit sheepish and going back with them on the boat.
Well, I think the reason that I can't remember is that my memories of the ending are of me sitting there thinking for like probably the third time watching this film. Why are they trying to so hard to justify not even offering to take this woman out of the jungle?
Yeah, like, so... Yeah.
They're working hard to just say, well, we'll just leave her here.
Isabel, this is Isabel's sister, and George is like, all she knows is the jungle. She doesn't want to come with you back to civilization and wear bras. She wants to stay here and let it all hang free. Yeah, so, yeah, they...
Live with the chimps, yeah.
Maybe you're right, but I can't find peace anymore.
Is that true?
Now that I've known her, I just can't forget her.
Why should you forget her? You'll be keeping a sweet memory alive of Luana and her happiness, which we in this jungle doesn't like us Europeans. It rejects us. It's all the world to her.
They don't even ask her. They just get on the boat and wave.
I know. It's such a that's my memory of the end of this film is just every time sitting there and thinking, couldn't you ask her? I mean, couldn't you say something like, do you want to come with us? This is your half sister. Maybe there should be some kind of connection here.
Yeah, they don't even really. I don't think she even has a conversation with her, or you know, any attempt at communication at all.
No, none.
She's pretty funny. So yeah, they just basically leave her behind, and that's the end of the film. Sorry, everybody, if you were hoping we weren't going to spoil it, but
I mean, sorry. Yes, some people live, some people die. Roll credits.
Yeah, I'm just checking the film now. Actually, I've got it in front of me to see who it is that falls in the plant.
Well, I would like to say that for whatever reason, in the small pond that is Jungle Girl films from the late 60s, I have to admit, this is one that I enjoy more than average. This one, it feels a little above average for the others because there are some elements in it that are a little more fantastical and a little more interesting. You mentioned the scorpion arm wrestling sequence, and there's the man-eating plant, which is pretty darn good little thing. I mean, that whole sequence with the man-eating plant, that's kind of fascinating. I don't know how much that thing cost, but it looked pretty darn good.
It is a KK who fell in. I'm just looking at it now.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, Fulbright, just I'm pretty sure he's just on the boat at the end. Let's have a look.
What, so I guess it? They're taking him back to the lawful officials.
Is he dead at the end? There's a whole thing with crocodiles as well at the beginning of the movie.
Oh, I know. It's like a bit of footage out of a Mondo film where we watch one crocodile kill and start eating another one.
Yeah. I wish I could remember what happened to Fulbright. Oh, doesn't he just get shot? Don't they have a fight and he shoots himself? Is it one of those? Anyway, no,
oh,
I think
that's
he is...
right. He does get shot. He's wrestling with George. That's right. Yeah.
He's getting shot, and George's close friend Mabogo,
mm-hmm.
who is with him for the whole time, or is it? No, it's not Mabogo.
Oh, no, he gets shot by George.
He's got another friend. He's got George has got another faithful friend with him who saves him from trouble a lot of times, and he shoots him. That's it. There we go. This is exciting. This makes for great listening, isn't it?
This is amazing podcasting. This is how you know that this film stands up and out from the past.
It stays in your mind. So I just wanted to end with the review from Monthly Film Bulletin. Strip cartoon poppycock, which might have been agreeably improved had the Chinese-looking and largely nude Jungle Girl been allowed a more prominent role in the scheme of things. The villain is from his first entrance so obviously villainous that the only question the script poses is how he will meet his just desserts.
Hmm.
In the event, he is assimilated by a carnivorous cabbage.
Carnivorous cabbage. That's not a bad way to put it.
So clearly this reviewer had the same problem that you and I just had. They couldn't remember who died in what way at the end, because they've remembered it as being Fulbright who died in the plant, but he didn't. He just got shot. And it was UKK who fell in the plant. So there you go. It's not just us that can't do
it. Yeah. Well, I got to be honest. This is very, very similar to any number of these particular films. There will be very little variation in terms of story or plot between any of these movies as we talk about them in this mini season. Mm-hmm. But this once again points out to me just one of the reasons why this was had to be a short-lived. Subgenre.
Yeah.
It has to be because invariably, for whatever reason, they make the choice that the Jungle Girl is going to be so passive as to be almost extraneous to the story being told. Once again, it would be easy to imagine, of course, there would be no exploitable thing for the poster art or or in, you know, the obvious draw of you know, mostly naked jungle girl to get butts in seats. But you could extract the jungle girl from the story completely and still have pretty much the same film. And because she has so little effect on anything that occurs in the story or plot, there's almost nothing there. It's really, it could easily be rewritten, and there did not seem to be the will or the desire to write a Jungle Girl film where the Jungle Girl was a full participant in the story and also savage and feel, you know, in a sense a kind of actual female version of Tarzan, a character that drives the story.
Yeah,
it's really strange. It's one of those things where you see this subgenre and realize, wow, so the title character is always going to be passive. That seems like a mistake.
Yeah, it's interesting. Well, we'll find out when with our next film. We've got two more to go. Let's see if the scripting opportunities improve. We've still got Samoa, starring Edwidge Fenech.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're going to do Tarzana the Wild Girl. So let's see if they get a better crack at some dialogue in those or not. But yeah, I think these would make for a great themed box set if somebody was brave enough to do that.
Oh, I would love to do. I would love to see interviews with anybody who survived, you know, who's able to be on camera. Just some information about the productions of these films would be fascinating.
And I do think they would scrub up really well, these movies, because they're mm-hmm. beautifully shot and they just need to look better than they do. This one is on YouTube and it's in English and it's not bad, but it's not great. And
yeah, I mean, it's what I would refer to as watchable on YouTube.
Yeah. With a star like Mei-Chen, you want to be able to appreciate the role and the craft more fully. So anyway, I think we'll leave it there before I say anything that I'll regret later. I just wanted to finish off. We had another email. I think last time we mentioned in an email from Lee Perkins how Tenebrae was apparently a post-apocalypse film. So you and I were both a bit confused by that. So this is according to something that Alan Jones said. So Lee says, to paraphrase from memory, Alan Jones said he liked the sparse, clean, low population look of Tenebrae, and Dario Argento said it was because it was after the apocalypse.
Really?
Oh, I see. And the what? Said Jones. He hadn't told anybody else, but the backstory was there had been a virological outbreak, vastly reducing Earth's population and also making the survivors hygiene obsessed. There you go. Apparently.
Okay.
That is the backstory behind Tenebrae that Argento didn't tell anyone or make it clear in the plot. But it does look quite futuristic in some ways, but yeah.
Yeah, in some ways it's true, but
there you go.
Wow. That's I've now got to schedule in a rewatch of Tenebrae.
Yeah, well, that's always going to be a good thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
You could never watch those films enough, so I'm sure that's worth it. Anyway, so I think we'll leave it there. Thank you everybody for joining us once again. And you can now take your loincloths off and hang them up.
Or leave them on, please.
I mean, leave it on, but it's getting chilly. but we'll be back in a couple of weeks with Samoa, I think is the next one.
Okay.
So that's something to look forward to.
Well, Edward Finch, come on.
Exactly. In the meantime, don't forget our plugs at the beginning. So you've got Dr. Jekyll and the Werewolf,
mm-hmm.
and also Danza Macabre Volume 2. If you haven't had enough of listening to Rod and I over 50 podcast episodes, then you can get more by listening to commentary tracks. And also, of course, Rod's podcast is still going strong over on the Bloody Pit. So whereas I haven't really got anything else to mention, I think I've plugged all there is. But yeah. Oh, I don't know. Did I mention it last time? Mark of the Devil, Vinegar Syndrome. I probably did.
Oh, anyway, you did mention Mark of the Devil. But you might want to bring that up one last time.
So yeah, just because that's not out yet, but it's been announced that I am on as a interview part on the bonus features for Mark of the Devil, which is another UHD release. They're coming thick and fast.
I know, more and more of them. I'm not surprised by some of the choices that are being made to upgrade to 4K, but I'm a little, I don't have any plans to buy a 4K player anytime soon. So yeah.
No, well, it's difficult to save up to buy one when you keep buying the discs.
Yes, exactly.
It's like a catch-22. There's no point buying a player if you haven't got any discs, but you can't afford the player because you keep buying the discs.
It is a horrible situation to be in, a vicious circle.
I know, like, we have it so tough. That's sarcasm, in case anybody can't tell. Okay, anyway, thank you everybody for listening. Please do, subscribe, which you probably already are because you're listening to this. But tell your friends to subscribe. Share us on social media, or just, if you're walking through the jungle, just jump up on a vine, swing through the trees, shouting Wild Wild Podcast, and let's see if we can get a few more listeners that way.
Or if that will simply bring the gendarmes to take you away. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you again, Rod, for doing this. It's always fun.
Always a blast. Thank you for doing this little mini season of Jungle Girl Films. It does my heart good.
Yes, we're doing this just for you. So. It's...
Yes, I know that you don't enjoy this at all.
It's like charity work. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Bye for now.
Bye-bye, everyone.